this morning's presentation, I'm going to deal with a number of practical questions with regard to three topics: the presentation of the libellus, the formulation of the doubt, and the sentence. In the course of examining the annual reports submitted by local tribunals and various sentences and even the acts of particular cases, the apostolic signator often notes certain similar difficulties in many tribunals. In this presentation, I would like to concentrate on three key moments in the canonical trial: the presentation of the libellus, the formation of the doubt, and the sentence. As you know, the signator receives not only the annual reports, which it examines, but oftentimes requests sentences and also the observations of the defender of the bond and other acts from particular causes in order to understand better how the tribunals are functioning. And it's from the study of those materials that I draw the presentation this morning. The presentation of the libellus: the petitioner calls on the ministry of the tribunal to resolve a controversy, usually the alleged nullity of the marriage. The formulation of the doubt: the tribunal, having accepted the petition and considered not only what the petitioner has proposed, but also the observations and responses of the other party and the defender of the bond, determines the terms of the controversy, setting in precise juridical terms the questions which it will seek to resolve. Third, the sentence: the tribunal, having considered the proofs gathered and the arguments proposed and discussed, renders a judgment, giving an answer to the question or questions. Rather than simply giving a list of common problems, I would like to offer some positive suggestions to assist tribunals in avoiding common difficulties in these areas. The presentation of the libellus first. One of the positive accomplishments of the Church in the United States is to have provided the tribunal structures and personnel needed in order to make the ministry of justice generally available to the faithful. An important aspect of the munus regendi, the office of governing of the diocesan bishop, described in Lumen Gentium number 27, a service that is based on the impartial search for the truth. In order to be true to its nature and purpose, the tribunal must not only be impartial and fair, but it must strive to be perceived as such as well. This is a very important point. We not only have to do what is right, we have to seem to do what is right. If we give the impression of being involved in something that's not impartial, even though we are maintaining impartiality, we're responsible for that, and so a great deal of discretion and prudence needs to be exercised. As an impartial body, the tribunal cannot on its own initiative decide to investigate a question, such as the nullity of a particular marriage, but only upon the legitimate request or petition of an interested party or the promoter of justice. Here I refer to Article 115 of Dignitas Connubii. At the same time, the tribunal actively seeks to make its ministry of justice accessible to the faithful, to offer assistance to both parties in exercising their rights in the process according to the law. One of the ways in which it balances these two aspects of its ministry, that impartiality, which must shine forth in everything that the tribunal does, and at the same time offering assistance to parties, is by respecting the proper separation of roles and functions. While everyone involved in a canonical process should have the same ultimate goal, to find the truth, each person must do so according to his or her proper function, as Pope Pius XII explained so luminously in his allocation to the Roman Rota in 1944, and I do very much commend that to you. I don't know if you've seen this collection of discourses to the Roman Rota by Father Westman, who was a professor at Ottawa for many years, Father William Westman, the Oblate of Mary Immaculate. But it's a very helpful little volume to have access to all of these discourses. And from the time of Pius XII at least, there is, in, especially in his discourses and those of Paul VI, John Paul II, Benedict XVI, there's a very substantial resource for us in our tribunal work. In this context, it is important to maintain the proper distinction between the tribunal ministers, the judicial vicar, adjunct judicial vicar, judge, auditor, assessor, defender of the bond, promoter of justice, and notary, who each have a distinct public function. So I went, oops, sorry, it's not important. So on the one side, we have those officers of the tribunal. Oh, thank you, Father. And on the other side, we have the advocates, whose function it is to defend individual parties and also to act in their name if they are also procurators. As indicated in Dignitas Connubii, Article 102, if both parties to a marriage believe that the marriage was invalid, they can choose the same procurator and or advocate if there is otherwise no conflict of interest, as there would be, for example, if they do not agree on the reasons for the alleged nullity or the alleged invalidity. The ministers of the tribunal, on the other hand, on the one hand, can never be pro parte. In other words, the ministers of the tribunal are never acting on behalf of the parties, while the advocate must always be acting on behalf of the parties. And that then establishes a proper kind of dialectic so that the court can more easily reach the truth, the judge can more easily form a judgment with moral certitude. One might see an exception in the case of the defender of the bond, whose interests may seem to coincide with those of a respondent who is opposing a declaration of nullity. And sometimes it's said that the respondent, that it doesn't violate the right of defense of the respondent who opposes a declaration of nullity not to provide him an advocate because there's a defender of the bond. But the defender of the bond is not representing any one of the parties. He's representing the church. He's the defensor, as Pope Benedict XIV said, the defensor matrimoniorum on behalf of the church. And so while he may bring forth arguments which are favorable, obviously, to the position of the party who opposes a declaration of nullity, he is not the representative of the respondent who opposes the declaration of nullity. In order to safeguard this distinction between ministers and advocates, the law provides that no minister of the tribunal can ever act as an advocate at the same first instance tribunal and at its appellate tribunal. This prevents even the suspicion that the advocate might have some particular influence because of his or her other position in one of these connected tribunals. At the same time, by offering both parties the assistance of trained advocates, the tribunal provides specific help to the parties without losing its own impartiality. This separation should be clear from the very beginning, that is, from when a party approaches the tribunal. And I'll give you some specific examples. First, there is the question of the preliminary information provided by the tribunal. Many tribunals already have information in printed form and or on their website explaining the nature and function of the tribunal as an impartial instrument for discerning the truth. Such information should be balanced, providing useful information not only for those who might wish to present a petition for a declaration of nullity, but also for those who might wish to oppose such a declaration. It should also avoid language which, even unintentionally, can imply a certain partiality or prejudice, such as the unfortunate expression, former spouse. That is an expression we really need to avoid, because it already shows one's hand that the presumption is that there is no marriage. If it's the former spouse, then you must think that there's no marriage there. So it's just terminology to be avoided. And the same way, too, in the information that the tribunal makes available, it shouldn't simply be from the point of view of helping someone who wants to contest the validity of the marriage or wants to allege the nullity of the marriage, but also how does someone who wants to defend the validity of his or her marriage receive help at the tribunal. Secondly, the instruction Dignitas Connubii recommends that the tribunal have an office or person responsible for providing information about the possibility of introducing a cause of nullity and the manner in which this is to be done. This personal assistance can even include giving general information about the various grounds of nullity for those who are interested. At this level, however, this is just a conversation about how the tribunal works. Even so, in order to safeguard the impartiality of the trial, any tribunal minister who provides such preliminary information to a party, thus establishing a certain rapport with that person, cannot then take part in the concrete cause as judge or defender of the bond. On the other hand, if one of the tribunal advocates does this, he or she can then act as the petitioner's advocate, and certainly there'd be nothing wrong with having one of the advocates also serve the tribunal by providing this kind of information, and then later if the party wishes to choose that person to be his or her advocate, there would be no conflict in him or in her doing that. We had one case, I remember, rather large tribunal in Italy where the judicial vicar, he said out of his strong pastoral sense, would meet with every party who came forward to seek a declaration of nullity of marriage and counsel them and help them to present their libellus and so forth, what created a tremendously bad impression in the local church, because the people all presumed, well, if he's received them so kindly and helping them and so forth to present their libellus and so forth, he must be partial. And so those who were opposing the declaration, they felt that the judicial vicar was already prejudiced in the case. It simply wasn't appropriate. Third, there is the decision whether or not to present a petition and then the preparation of the libellus. Ideally, at this point, the potential petitioner will have the assistance of an advocate. Here is the function of the advocate, not a tribunal minister, to discuss the specific details of the marriage with a potential petitioner and to advise that person whether or not there seems to be the basis or ground for a cause of nullity, and if so, what ground or grounds of nullity. In order to gather information about the marriage and possible ground or grounds of nullity, the advocate may have the potential petitioner prepare an account of the circumstances before and during the marriage, or may ask the petitioner to respond to a series of questions or to fill out a questionnaire. Some of the application forms, as they're called, that the signatura is seen and used by some tribunals would be more appropriately used by advocates for this purpose. Again, it is the task of the advocate, not the tribunal, to explore every possible ground of nullity and review all the information provided by the petitioner, filtering out those things which are irrelevant, unnecessary, or offensive, leaving only what is essential. At the same time, the advocate is only advising the potential petitioner, who must take responsibility for the petition, who should understand and agree with what the advocate has proposed before signing and submitting the petition or libellus to the tribunal. I must emphasize that as yet the tribunal is not involved with the question, other than providing general information and offering the assistance of an advocate. It is only when a libellus is presented that the tribunal is constituted, or our tribunal is constituted, to hear the case. Here I refer to Article 118 of Dignitas Connubii. I'll talk in a few minutes about the different elements of the libellus. Unfortunately, the apostolic signatura still encounters situations in which the tribunal effectively plays the part of advocate for prospective petitioners. In a misplaced desire to be helpful, and it's always presumed that this is the motive of such a tribunal, that they want to be helpful to the faithful, the tribunal office says, in essence, give us as much information as possible about your marriage, and we will look over everything and see if there is any basis for nullity, and if so, draw a petition for you to sign. This is very different from simply providing general information about how to prepare a libellus or providing a list of available advocates. The apostolic signature, in fact, receives complaints from some respondents who feel, with some justification, that the tribunal is partial to the petitioner, from the very beginning. They do not perceive that the tribunal is offering them the same assistance in defending the marriage as it offered the petitioner in challenging the validity of their marriage. This perception of partiality is confirmed when the tribunal acts in certain ways. For example, failing to attach a copy of the libellus to the citation, or even to communicate the essential information about the petition, even upon request. Failing to offer the assistance of an advocate, or offering an advocate who does nothing to assist the respondent, or even acts against the interests of the respondent. A related problem that is still encountered is that of tribunals which seek to gather the proofs, instruct the case, before even deciding whether or not to accept the libellus. Already in 1950, the great jurist Vittorio Bartocchetti, later secretary of the Apostolic Signatura, warned against such a practice. He wrote in his in the famous volumes, the Commentarios in Judice Ecclesiastica, which he added together with the great Cardinal Michael Lega. He said that such a practice should be avoided lest the case be tried before the case begins and the process carried out before the process. When it perceives such a practice on the part of some tribunal, the apostolic signature often points out several difficulties for the proper administration of justice. For example, before accepting the libellus, the tribunal can undertake a brief investigation, but based on what is alleged in the libellus, not before the libellus is even presented. In other words, if no libellus is presented, there's no case before the tribunal, and therefore it's not appropriate for it to be doing an investigation. Dignitas Connubii, in Article 160, explains why the tribunal is not to proceed to collecting any form of proof before the formulation of the doubt, except for a grave reason. The formulation of the, if there's some urgency, it can, but normally speaking, this is not the case. The formulation of the doubt delimits the matter to be investigated, and that's then makes possible the collection of proofs. From one point of view, this helps the tribunal to focus on the specific issues in question, avoids tiring parties and witnesses with questions about other matters, reduces the amount of data to be reviewed, and so forth. From another point of view, the tribunal has no right to delve indiscriminately into all the details of the personal life of the parties. There is a big difference between the initial question of whether or not a petition has some fumus boni juris, that is, does there seem to be a case here, or even whether such could arise during the investigation of the case, and the final question of whether or not the nullity of marriage has been proven. A confusion of the two could lead to two types of errors. On the one hand, if the tribunal demands that the nullity of the marriage be practically proven in advance, it could unjustly deprive the petitioner of a canonical process. In other words, if the tribunal is already convinced before the process even begins that the marriage is null, there more than likely is not going to be a serious process carried out to instruct the case properly. On the other hand, if the acceptance of a petition signifies that a negative decision has been practically excluded, the subsequent judicial process could amount to a mere formality. In the former case, rejecting for lack of proof of nullity, it is true that the petitioner has the right to have recourse against the rejection of the libellus, either to the collegiate tribunal or to the appellate tribunal. But some tribunals prefer to give what they call an informal rejection of a petition, so that the party has to insist on a formal decree of rejection. And even when the collegiate court or appellate court admits the libellus, the petitioner may perceive that the tribunal has already made up its mind. In the latter case, admission only after proof of nullity, it is easy to see why a respondent could perceive a lack of impartiality on the part of the tribunal. In case of doubt, the church's law favors the marriage bond and places the burden of proof on the petitioner. But in such cases, it can seem to a respondent that the tribunal is starting the formal process with a bias in favor of nullity. Now, a few words about the libellus. The libellus itself should be fairly succinct, containing the basic elements described in Articles 116 and 117 of Dignitas Connubii. Article 116, in its first part, reads, a libellus by which a cause is introduced must, one, express the tribunal before which the cause is to be introduced. This is very straightforward. The petition is addressed to a specific tribunal. Describe the object of the cause, that is, specify the marriage in question, present a petition for a declaration of nullity, and propose, although not necessarily in technical terms, the reason for petitioning, that is, the ground or grounds of nullity on which the marriage is being challenged. So that's Article 116, 1 and 2. As I mentioned before, the petitioner must take responsibility for the petition. Some tribunals have a pre-printed form for a libellus, which simply indicates that the marriage is null for a defect of consent. This is not sufficient. This is not a libellus. Number three under Article 116 in its first section reads, indicate at least in a general way the facts and proofs on which the petitioner is relying in order to demonstrate what is being asserted. It is not enough to give a list of witnesses without providing some facts about which they should be questioned. In other words, you indicate the name of the witness and what that witness, what bearing that witness has or the testimony you will give on the question of nullity that's being raised. Just to list the names of witnesses is not sufficient. Number four, under the first section of Article 116, it must be signed by the petitioner or his procurator, indicating also the day, month, and year, as well as the place in which the petitioner or his advocate live or declare they reside, for the purpose of receiving acts. That's clearly very important, that we know where both parties are so that they can receive the acts. And then number five, indicate the domicile or quasi-domicile of the other spouse. Then the second section of this same Article 116, there should be attached to the libellus an authentic copy of the marriage certificate and, if need be, a document of the civil status of the parties. If there's already intervened a civil divorce, there should be a copy of the document which attests to that. And it's not permissible to require expert reports at the time when the petition in the third section reads, it is not permissible to require expert reports at the time when the petition is being exhibited. Then Article 117, if proof through documents is being proposed, these and as much as possible are to be submitted with the petition. This would be the case of nullity because of a prior bond. If, however, proof through witnesses is being proposed, their names and domiciles are to be indicated. If other proofs are being proposed, there should be indicated, at least in general, the facts or indications from which they are to be brought to, from which they are to be brought to light. Nothing, however, prevents further proofs of any kind from being brought forth in the course of the trial. In this initial phase, therefore, the importance of the distinction of functions is already clear. Only now does the tribunal begin to function as such, as the tribunal is constituted and the judge must decide whether or not to accept the libellus. The tribunal that remains impartial and yet truly accessible to the faithful who seek an answer to questions that touch directly upon their life of faith, upon their eternal salvation, this requires the existence of the tribunal and that it should operate in the truest manner possible. The impartiality is safeguarded at the beginning of the process, and the accessibility of justice is made possible through providing accurate general information and then the specific assistance of a prepared advocate. Now I proceed to the second practical question, the formulation of the doubt. The next important moment which I wish to discuss is the formulation of the doubt. Some of the difficulties encountered by the apostolic signatura concern the object of the controversy to be resolved, the doubt or doubts to be resolved by way of the judicial process, the questions to which the judge, at the end of the day, must give a response. In fact, sometimes appellate courts have difficulty as well because of the way that the doubts were proposed in first instance. Some of the following observations are based on what was encountered in individual sentences, while others are based on the categories used by tribunals in their annual report to the apostolic signatura. The judge begins with the ground or grounds proposed in the libellus, putting it into correct canonical terms if necessary, invites the other party to respond to it, and at the same time, too, this is the point of intervention, to respond to it, then establishes the doubt based on the input of the parties and the defender of the bond. In doing so, the judge must see that the formulation is correct, both in terms of substance and form. Here, I might just refer again to the question that was raised yesterday. For various reasons, Mitis Judex insists that the judicial vicar sets the grounds, but there would be no way that the judicial vicar could do this work properly without first having the judgment of the judge in the case, who has done all of this work in terms of examining the libellus and making precise the exact ground of nullity. Now, this formulation is correct both in terms of substance and form. In regard to the substance, the ground of nullity itself should be indicated in canonical terms recognized in current rotal jurisprudence, even making reference to the canons in question. At times, the signatura and creative formulations of the doubt, which are difficult to correlate with current acceptable jurisprudence, or which reveal a misunderstanding of the ground in question, or which are so general that they are useless. To formulate a doubt, effective consent is useless. It doesn't provide any direction, or any kind of roadmap to gathering proofs of nullity. These are some of the unacceptable formulations which have been encountered: relative incapacity, lack of commitment, defective consent on the ethical plane, exclusion of consortium vitae, defect of consent in the formal object, pressured consent, and insufficient consent. Those are just some examples. In regard to the form of the doubt, one cannot give a clear answer if the question itself is confused or imprecise. In matrimonial cases, each doubt often has two specific elements: the ground of nullity and the party involved. The ground of nullity itself should not only be formulated in terms recognized in rotal jurisprudence, but it should also be made as specific as possible. Some formulations are obviously too vague, such as defective consent, incapacity, error of law. If the nullity of marriage is alleged on the basis, for example, of simulation or exclusion, the doubt should indicate whether the alleged simulation was total or partial, and if partial, it should indicate the specific element or property that was excluded from consent by a positive act of the will. Likewise, if the petitioner alleges an error that determined the will — here we refer to Canon 1099 that we were discussing yesterday — the doubt should indicate the object of the error, that is, what was excluded from matrimonial consent by a positive act of the will because of the error. If the cause concerns psychic incapacity, the doubt should specify which of the three kinds of incapacity indicated in 1095 is involved. Most grounds also require the specification of the party or parties involved. If both parties are involved, then there are two separate doubts to be answered. One encounters sometimes an ambiguous expression like mutual incapacity to assume the essential obligations of marriage. There doesn't exist a mutual incapacity. You have the incapacity of one party, the incapacity of the other, but there's no sharing in that. In other words, it doesn't. When there are multiple questions proposed, the relationship among them should be specified, that is, whether they are concurrent and or subordinate. Whether they are concurrent and or, make myself clear, if there are two grounds that are concurrent with one another, then marriage is null for on this ground and that ground, or on this ground or that ground, or subordinate, the marriage is null on this ground, and if not, on this other ground. At times, multiple doubts which are mutually exclusive are formulated as concurrent doubts. For example, total simulation on the part of the petitioner and or force or fear inflicted on the petitioner. These two are mutually exclusive, because the person who gives consent under force and fear consents to marriage, doesn't simulate. If he's simulating, then the ground is simulation, but the two can't exist together. The ground of simulation posits a positive act of the will on the part of someone who is capable of admitting a valid consent but chooses not to. In both cases, if there is an affirmative decision on the first ground, then there is no need for a decision on the second ground. Another difficulty is encountered at times with the tendency of some tribunals to take what some call a shotgun approach, allowing too many concurrent doubts, which then are not all investigated with the same diligence. For example, at some tribunals, there is a standard concurrent doubt of the two types of incapacity, of Canon 1095, numbers 2 and 3, on the part of both spouses. This is already incorrect insofar as a correct understanding of the two grounds in question would lead to a subordinate formulation. But when the tribunal then focuses on only one of the several grounds, giving an affirmative decision on that ground and a negative on all the others, even without much argument, this could unjustly preclude the introduction of a new case in first instance on those other grounds. In other words, if the tribunal in first instance has already responded to those grounds, then in second instance you can't introduce them again. It is better to concentrate on the grounds for which the petitioner has already offered some basis, some fumus boni juris. If from the investigation into those questions information comes to light that would point to a different ground of nullity, then the ground can be changed according to the norm of law. The formulation of the doubt is important because it sets the parameters for the gathering of proofs. The discussion of the case and final decision is important. For the gathering of the proofs, the discussion of the case and the final decision, it is important, therefore, that the formulation be done properly, being correct in its substance and in its form. Now we get to the last question, the sentence. The canonical process or trial is concluded by the decision of the judge, that is, the response to the doubt and its communication to the parties. It is not, however, enough that the bare decision of the judge be communicated. It is required that this be expressed in a sentence which indicates not only what was decided, but also the reasons for the decision. Experience teaches that having to explain the reasons for a decision helps to keep the judge on track. It shows respect for the dignity of the persons involved and demonstrates that the tribunal did not make an arbitrary or superficial decision. In marriage cases, this requirement also witnesses to the gravity of what is at stake, holy matrimony, whether the decision is affirmative or negative. Pope St. John Paul II, in his allocution to the Roman Rota in 1989 concerning the right of defense of the parties in the matrimonial process, gave two particular reasons for the communication of the reasons for the decision, especially to the parties who may not have obtained the decision they desired. He asks, how can it be possible to make a reasoned challenge of a decision without knowing the reasons for it? He also notes that knowing the reasons for the decision may make it easier for a person to accept the church's judgment, especially when that person has exhausted all the means of challenging that decision. So the sentence is of vital importance for all these reasons. There's no need to dwell here on the importance of the publication of the entire sentence to the parties who are directly affected by it. It is true that many people who are in favor of the nullity of the marriage have little interest in knowing the reasons for the decision as long as they obtain the decision they desire. And they are certainly free to waive their right to a copy of the sentence or even the possibility of reading it. But it is an evident injustice to deny parties the right to know the reasons for the decision or to make it excessively burdensome for them to do so. With this in mind, I would like to concentrate more on the contents of the sentence. Some years ago, a special commission of experts of the Holy See studied some sentences issued by tribunals around the world. Among their findings was the following. Since matrimonial cases are daily growing in number, and in some of them the facts are very similar, the decisions unconsciously tend toward a certain uniformity and automatic repetitions, both as regards the law and, what is more deplorable, in the application of the law to the facts, where the greatest effort on the part of the judge is required. Thus, in writing their decisions, judges sometimes can easily fall into a kind of mere formalism, and it not infrequently happens that under the appearance of solemn and lengthy procedure, the substance of the whole trial is reduced to schematic formulae, which are either prepared by the attorney of the party and presented to the judges, or what is worse, are drawn up by the judge almost automatically from the evidence that has been offered. We call attention to the conduct of some judges who, in weighing the evidence, do not act as real judges, but rather as simple compilers. They attend to the form of words without weighing them critically, without consideration or reasoning. They put together excerpts from the testimony of witnesses or experts and draw the facile conclusion that the case presents credible and concordant testimony establishing the nullity of marriage. I said that this study was done some years ago. In fact, I have just read an excerpt from a circular letter of August 15th, 1949. So you see that the problems that we face today were already noted at that time. And that was given by the Sacred Congregation for the Discipline of the Sacraments, which was then charged with vigilance over matrimonial causes. Unfortunately, the experience of the Supreme Tribunal of the Apostolic Signatura, to whom that task of vigilance was given in 1967, has been that the same difficulties persist today. There are still judges who act more as compilers than real judges, whose sentences are little more than a concatenation of excerpts from the testimony of parties, witnesses, and experts, with little critical weighing of the evidence and little or no actual argumentation. And I must say that with all the benefits of computerization, this, I think, has aggravated this situation considerably. The possibility of simply pasting text back and forth, sometimes it's very difficult to find the argument in the sentence. Rather than beginning with a list of defects found, I would like to begin a brief reminder of what a sentence is meant to be, with particular reference to the valuable assistance given by the instruction Dignitas Canubi, especially in Title 10, the pronouncements of the judge. I commend that very much to you. Article 250 of the Dignitas Canubi states that the sentence must decide the question being debated before the tribunal with an appropriate response given to each of the doubts, and two, present the arguments or reasons in law and in fact on which the dispositive part of the sentence is based. Now, response to a doubt or doubts. It is evident that the judicial sentence is above all an instrument for communicating the decision itself. In its essence, that decision has a starting point and a conclusion, a doubt and a response, a question and an answer. The doubt is established at the beginning of the process in the contestatio litis, although it can be modified in the course of the process, and the answer is given at the end. And so Article 250 of Dignitas Canubi says that the sentence must decide the question being debated before the tribunal with an appropriate response given to each of the doubts. In a case being judged by a collegiate tribunal, the answer is given in the session of the judges. Article 214, paragraph 6, reads, when a decision has been agreed upon, the ponens is to write it in the form of an affirmative or negative response to the doubt proposed, then sign it together with the other judges and attach it to the dossier of the acts. The ponens then must draw up the sentence. So in the moment of the judgment itself, the dispositive part is redacted by the ponens. He and the other judges sign it. That's attached to the acts, but then he has the responsibility to draw up the sentence and submit it for the approval and signature of the other judges. In a case being judged by a single judge, obviously there is no session of judges, unless the judge is given to talking to himself, but when the discussion phase of the process has been completed, the judge must sit down and make a decision and then draw up the sentence. A good sentence will begin by stating the formula of doubt to be resolved exactly as it was set, and will conclude with a clear response to each specific question. The reasons for the response. The pars motiva, the part that gives the reason for the sentence, it consists of the arguments or reasons in law and in fact on which the dispositive part of the sentence is based. And it really is it's the heart of the sentence. It reveals the roadmap that leads the reader from the question to the answer. In fact, Dignitas Canubi uses this image to describe the motivation part of the sentence. In Article 254, Part 1, it reads, "The sentence, avoiding both an excessive brevity and an excessive length, must be clear in explaining the reasons in law and in fact, and must be based on the acts and proofs, so that it is apparent by what path the judges arrived at their decision and how they applied the law to the facts." At the same time, Dignitas Canubi reminds us that our roadmap should be sober and respectful. The presentation of the facts, however, as the nature of the matter requires, is to be done prudently and cautiously, avoiding any offense to the parties, the witnesses, the judges, and the other ministers of the tribunals. And I can't stress this enough. Countless difficulties have been encountered with tribunals because the judges, the person who writes the sentence, takes the occasion to make statements about offensive statements about either the parties themselves or about the officers of the tribunal. There's no place for that in any sentence. Or to introduce facts which are offensive but have nothing to do with the heart of the decision. And I can't stress this enough with you. Some people have been unduly influenced by the type of adversarial form of argumentation in civil law tribunals, and they let this enter into canonical jurisprudence, and it has no place. I think I better draw this to a conclusion. I have prepared too much material, but anyway, let me just—I think we can. Didn't realize this was so going on so long. I think the rest of this, I simply take art, describe the introductory part, the exposition of the facts, the factus speeches, and then the argument in law. And here should be introduced solely those articles of the law which pertain to the ground or grounds under discussion. And this can be done very succinctly. So the uniure section should indicate the principles of law that the judge actually follows in arriving at the conclusion. Obviously, they have to be sound, consistent with the church's law and doctrine, reflecting consolidated rodal jurisprudence. And then the law applied to the facts. There, that quote that I read from the Congregation for the Discipline of the Sacraments is very helpful. That the judge doesn't engage in a kind of superficial presentation of the argument in facto, but with a diligence and thoughtfulness applies the law to the particular case. Well, with that, I hope that these remarks also about the sentence in a matrimonial cause will have brought to your attention the importance of the sentence as a means of communicating two things, that the church, through the work of its tribunals, takes marriage seriously, and that it takes the parties in the marriage seriously. In a certain way, the sentence should be a mirror of the whole process, a process which began with the tribunal receiving and accepting the request of the petitioner, expressed in anabellus, a process in which the question which the tribunal was legitimately empowered to answer was set forth in a correct manner, a process which was then carried out to investigate and debate that same question, a process which finally ended with the pondered and reasoned decision of the judge, explained and communicated in the sentence. Just as the church is called to be a mirror of justice, so the sentence should be the mirror of a just process and a just decision. Well, thank you very much for your very kind attention. It's not easy to have to listen to the same presenter for 2 days running, but you've been extremely gracious. It's been a great pleasure to meet all of you, and I promise that I won't forget you in your prayers. I want to thank again Monsignor Padazinski for his inspiration in suggesting to Archbishop Cordiglione to ask me to come and be with you. Monsignor Padazinski showed a certain wisdom. He chose a John the Baptist to whom it would be very difficult for me to say no. I've known Archbishop Cordiglione for many years, since he was first my student, and I began to appreciate very much his gifts, both as a priest and as a canonist, and I've been privileged to continue to enjoy his friendship over these years. And so I say Monsignor Padazinski was very, he was as innocent as a dove and as sly as a serpent in making this request. But anyway, thank you very much. Your work is so important. So oftentimes in the whole economy of things, we see so many things going on worldwide and in the church, and we can begin to doubt the work that we're doing and think, well, it's just little and insignificant, but that's not the case at all. The salvation of a single soul merits all of our attention, and so your work, you should never question the importance of it and never give way to discouragement, which I always say is Satan's first temptation. People think the horrible sins are what he tempts us with first. No, he first, I think, tempts us to be discouraged about our capacity to live a good and holy life. And then once he's accomplished that, then he can move on to other things. So don't be discouraged. Be of good courage. And I would ask you then finally to please remember me in your prayers as I continue also to provide whatever service I can to the church. This is all about for all of us, and I see that in you, and I hope you have perceived it in me. It's all about our love for our Lord and for His holy church. So thank you very much, and God bless you.